Hi everyone, this is Tom with the community team, and in this video tutorial we're going to take a look at optimizing your security policy. Let's take a look at a couple of example policies. An administrator that just started setting up his appliance might be tempted to use any in the source and or destination for their security policy, because that's easy to work with. You don't need to take care, your zones are accurate before you start working. But those configurations tend to stay there for a while and might actually introduce some security risks, because you kind of tend to lose control or sight over where your traffic is going and can be coming from. So as an example, I've set up a LAN connection and a WAN connection over here. And these are set to intra-zone and inter-zone instead of universal. So what's the difference between these three? A universal policy will apply in any direction. So a local source zone is going to be allowed to the local destination zone and remote destination zone. And then the remote source zone will be allowed to the local destination and the remote destination. If you have an intranet zone set, this means that even if you have a mixture of all your zones in the source and the destination, they'll only be allowed to connect to their own zone. So that means a local will only be allowed to connect back to the local zone, and the remote source zone will only be allowed to connect back to the remote destination zone. While inter-zone is going to be the reverse, the local source zone is only going to be allowed to talk to any destination zone that isn't itself. And then the remote source zone is only going to be allowed to talk to any other destination zone except itself. So local and any other zones, but not remote. Another important step to improve your security is to change the service from any to application default or a static set of ports, depending on your needs. But at least make sure that there is no any left. So go ahead and change this to application default. Application default. Since PanOS 6.0, if you create a new security policy, it's going to be application default by default. But it might be worth revisiting your security policy. It might have been there for a while. And if it has been set to any manually or was created before you migrated to PanOS 6.0, there might still be services set to any, which is not optimal. Why is this? For example, any session that gets created on the firewall is going to pass through the firewall policy twice, which means that when you receive your SYN packet, app ID is not going to be able to identify an application just yet because it's new, there's no data in there yet. The only thing the firewall has is the 5-tuple set of source zone, source subnet, destination zone, destination subnet, and destination port. So for example, if you're running a security policy that is only going to allow web browsing on port 80 and DNS on a UDP port 53, any session coming in or going out on port 22 should be denied. If your service is set to any, the handshake will be let through and app ID will need to determine if this application is web browsing or something completely different. Which means that in this scenario, where the application is still set to any, we won't be able to restrict the creation of sessions based on the destination port just yet, because there aren't any applications that can guide the application default to only allow certain ports to be open during the session creation phase. In many cases, especially when a firewall administrator is creating his very first policy, he might not be aware which applications to allow or deny. Maybe there are a couple of straightforward applications like web browsing and SSL, DNS, that might be allowed, but there are many others where it might not be as easy to determine which ones to deny and to allow. For cases like that, there's a nifty feature that's called the application filter. The application filter is a sort of group that groups your applications by means of their behavior. So what you can do, for example, I have my block apps filter here. I've selected all the subcategories I do not like and the risk factor I do not like, and it's going to populate the list of applications automatically, which also means that if in the near future a new application becomes available through a dynamic update which is added to the application repository, which matches these parameters, it's automatically going to be added to my list. So if I do the same thing for my allowed applications, so I create, for example, an allowed apps filter, and I select services that I like for example, authentication, maybe some database internally, ERP, internal file sharing, do not like gaming, general business, some internet utility. And I select the technology that I like. For example, I do not want peer-to-peer, so browser-based, client-server, network protocol, and I only want the fairly low-risk until high-ish risk applications, but nothing that's a risk factor of 5. I now have a friendly list of applications of things that I trust based on the category, subcategory, technology, and risk factor without going in and pinpointing specific applications that I want to allow. If I now go back to my security policy and add them, in here, this will make your environment a lot more secure. Another thing that's often overlooked are the security profiles. In all cases, I would recommend administrators to create their own security profiles instead of using the default. This will help you get more acquainted to what is available to you. And secondly, it's also going to allow you to set a couple of features that are not available in the default profile. For example, if we go to the antivirus profile and create a new one, we can set packet captures. This is going to create a little packet capture each time a virus is detected, which can be helpful if you want any post-mortem information or want to investigate what's going on the network. It also includes a set of wildfire actions which aren't included in the default profile. Next, in the anti-spyware profile, we can create a profile that's just a little more aggressive than the default one by, for example, setting the action to reset or block IP instead of the default action assigned to a specific anti-spyware thread. And you can also collect packet captures. Another neat feature in the anti-spyware profile is that you can enable DNS sinkholes, which means that if in your organization a host sends out a DNS request for a malicious domain, that request is intercepted and the reply is spoofed with a different IP address than the actual host. This will serve two purposes. First off, it's going to interrupt any command and control sessions going out because they are not going to be able to reach the intended IP address to actually receive commands from out there, and it will be more easy to detect any hosts that have been infected because they'll be connecting to an IP address you know, being the sinkhole IP address. You can either choose to put in your own IP address, choose the IPv4 loopback on the host itself, which means that it's going to create a sinkhole on the host, which will not be detected by the firewall, or you can use a Palo Alto Networks provided sinkhole IP address on a public IP. If you're going to use your own IP address, make sure to not use an IP address that's actually being used inside the organization, because that's going to spawn connections to that host. You can also set an IPv6 sinkhole, and you can enable packet capture if you need to. Enabling passive DNS monitoring will send out anonymized DNS information to Palo Alto Networks, so we can gather that information and use it to improve our signatures. So if you can, I would recommend enabling this, as that will improve life for everyone. Another cool feature, if you do have your own dynamic block list, you can add it right here and set the action that needs to be applied to that. So you can allow block alert or sinkhole. For the vulnerability protection profile, you can create a profile that's also a little more aggressive. So for example, if we create a profile for anything that's critical or high from host type client, so meaning coming from the client, instead of taking the default action, we're going to block the IP address for a certain amount of time, for example, 600. We're going to enable extended packet capture. Client. And then we can create a similar rule for the server side. And then we can create policies for lower severity, medium, low, informational. You can set the action to drop instead of block the IP address. Client, we still want to have extended packet captures. And then we're going to clone that for the server side as well. Creating a custom URL filtering profile will allow you to change some of the logging attributes from the default. If you can see here, default has a lot of allow categories, which isn't a bad thing, but anything that's allowed in the URL filtering profile is not going to be logged by default. So if you want to get a view of what's being passed through your firewall, you can set all the actions to alert and then still block all the categories that you don't want to allow. But you'll get a log entry for each allowed category that's going through your firewall. When this is done, in the settings, you'll also be able to manipulate a couple of settings that you won't be able to change in the default one. For example, you can disable log container pages only, which will give you a full URL instead of just the host. You can enable safe search enforcement, which will make sure that your users are using Google in safe search mode only. You can add a couple of options to add to your logging. With this profile, you'll get far more information of what's being accessed by your users than the default one. For file blocking profile, I've actually created a different video called Tips from the Field File Blocking Profile. I'll add the link below. Make sure to check that out. It's really, really interesting and contains a lot of useful information of which file types you will want to block and why. Lastly, if you go to your security policy, make sure to actually change your profiles from anything that's default into all the stuff you just created, so you can take advantage of these profiles. Don't forget to add wildfire analysis. This will ensure that PE, APK, PDF, MS Office, JAR, and Flash files are uploaded to the wildfire cloud for analysis. If any of the uploaded files contain an infection, signatures can be created to block these files. Thanks for watching. I hope you liked the video. If you did, please hit the like button and don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Thanks.